Robert Gottfried. I'm here with my co-host Frank Santopadre at Nutmeg Post with our engineer Frank Ferdarosa. And this is Gilbert and Frank's Amazing Colossal Obsessions.
Bravo, sir.
Yes.
It took you, what, 27, 29? We grade him on a curve.
Yeah.
It took him a while to get the title.
Good job.
This is our little mini episode, and we're doing something we haven't done before. We always, Gil and I always do these ourselves, and we decided to keep our guests over.
Oh, yes.
Cliff Nesterhyven.
Nesterhyvenfeudel. Cliftenhyvenfeudel.
What did I start?
And Niftenkleivenhoff.
The author, Cliff Nesterhoff, and our friend Drew Friedman, the renowned cartoonist, are here, and they're going to sit in for our little mini episode. And I thought, I was looking around, I thought, well, we'll ask Drew and Cliff to sit in, but what is something that we can all share and we can all talk about? And I thought, what are Drew's obsessions? And I know on a previous show, you've been on the show twice, right, you are obsessed, and not in a good way, with the movie Skidoo.
Well, who wouldn't be?
You know, it's like, you know, I mean, it was one of those films that you never saw until fairly recently, and now everybody's seen it. And yes, it is as horrible as you ever heard it was, but even worse.
Worse.
But it's fascinating, you know, every moment of it.
Tell us the plot of Skidoo.
Oh, God. Well, I think Gilbert might be better at this because, you know, I didn't even follow the plot. I was just staring at it like a mental case, like a drooling mental
Otto Preminger film from 1968.
Yeah, well, it was like when, you know, all these directors were making big-budget comedies or big, you know, and Otto Preminger, who never made a comedy.
And they wanted to cash in on the 60s, but they were just out of it.
Clueless, yeah.
Yeah, and it was like, you know, they saw like Easy Rider and stuff like that becoming big hits. And what I remember hearing about Skidoo is John Philip Law starred in, and he was a handsome blonde guy, and he was originally asked to be Joe Buck in Midnight Cowboy, but it's quite rational. You figure, okay, I could play like a kind of a gay hooker in this movie, or I could be in a comedy with Groucho Marx and Jackie Gleason, directed by Otto Preminger.
It's got to be a hit.
Yeah,
right.
Well,
but oddly enough, Midnight Cowboy, Skidoo both feature music by Harry Nilsson.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, that's right.
An and Harry is in Skidoo, of course.
That's right.
Michael Sarrazin was also up for Midnight Cowboy, too, and turned it down for some of maybe The Flim Flam Man or something.
That's a good picture.
And oddly enough, Groucho Marx, who stars in Skidoo, hated Midnight Cowboy. And when he would do Cavett, it was one of his complaints. He'd always complain about hair on Broadway as being, you know, obscene. And he would complain about Midnight Cowboy, you know, probably one because it was rated X. But I think he famously said in an interview with Roger Ebert, have you seen this movie about called Midnight Cowboy? It's about a stud and a pimp. I wouldn't pay to go see this movie. Like, he really hated it.
And didn't Groucho also say, I think he goes, I was going to see hair on Broadway, but then I took off all of my clothes and stood in front of a full-length mirror and saved myself the money.
I have a question for Groucho. Groucho, why did you appear in Skidoo?
Because Chico needed the money.
We brought it back.
Groucho, Chico died 10 years before. So.
He was a gambler.
Well, apparently, though, Otto Preminger had done LSD with Timothy Leary prior to the film and prior to planning the film. And so he kind of was inspired by that. He wanted to do something, a movie that had something to do with LSD. Mm. And then Paul Krasner, who wrote The Realist, has
I found this on your website.
This story, it's in Paul Krasner's memoir. And when I wrote my book, I tried to determine whether this was apocryphal, an urban legend that Paul Krasner created, or if it was true, that Groucho Marx, in preparation for the movie Skidoo, wanted to see what LSD was like and did an acid trip. And Paul Krasner claims that Phil Oakes, the singer, provided them with the LSD and that they went to some actress's home in Beverly Hills, an empty house, and that he and Paul Krasner did LSD together and that Krasner was Groucho's guide because Groucho had been a subscriber to The Realist and so had read about this sort of counterculture elements and was curious. He was contemptuous of it but still curious about it. So Krasner claims that Groucho did acid once in preparation for the movie.
You see promos for the film, and Timothy Leary pops up in those promos.
Oh, yes. Right? Yeah.
And the strangest thing about the film is the actual cast they assembled, of course. With, of course, it's star Jackie Gleason, who takes an acid trip in the film.
Right. Yeah. He's the hitman.
Right. 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 And Arnold Stang is
Arnold
his buddy.
Arnold Stang. And we had Frankie Avalon on the show. Right. Side
and
note.
Carol Channing does a strip tease, which is possibly the most disturbing thing ever filmed.
And half the cast was also in the Batman series. Burgess Meredith is in
right.
it.
Gorshin.
Frank Gorshin is in it. Yeah.
And Preminger himself had played Mr.
Freeze.
Austin
Pendleton is in it.
Austin Pendleton.
It's like two separate casts, these young hippie types and then these old school. And Jackie Gleason is great because he's so angry throughout.
Right.
Because supposedly he hated Otto Preminger. They didn't get along.
Well, there's also an episode of Playboy After Dark in which they go on it to promote Skidoo before it comes out. And Harry Nilsson plays songs from the soundtrack at the piano. And Preminger's there in a Nehru suit being interviewed by a Hefner. And I can't remember which actors from the film are there. Groucho is not there and Gleason's not there.
Peter Lawford, maybe?
Peter Lawford, probably.
Tell Gilbert it was Cesar Romero, just for
real. Oh, yeah, Cesar Romero.
Oh, yeah.
You know about Otto Preminger. He shared the same passion that Danny Thomas did. I've heard this.
Of getting shit on with the glass coffee table.
I don't think there was actually with Preminger, I don't think there was a glass coffee table involved.
He just got shit on
basically,
directly.
That's what I've heard, yeah. I've heard that.
And by critics, figuratively, when Skidoo came out.
And in case I've never told this story, Cesar Romero liked to have orange wedges flung in his naked ass. Wow.
You know that. You must know that.
Wow. No.
Yeah.
They're tangerines, right? And they had to be half ripe. Very specific.
Well, if you think about it, an orange would hurt. So
yes. They had to be like kind of half rotten tangerine wedges. And he'd have young boys throw them at his, and then he would jerk off.
Some people say they were clementines.
Yeah, yeah.
There is a YouTube.
Could be a book.
There's a footage on YouTube of Skip E. Lowe interviewing Cesar Romero in the early 80s.
Skip E. Lowe.
Why don't you get Skip E. Lowe for the show?
And there is a real serious, weird gay subtext there where it's almost as if Skip E. Lowe is trying to get Cesar to come out of the closet on his show, and Cesar Romero is very.
Butch Romero.
Yeah, he's very nasty to Skip E. Lowe, as I'm sure most people were, but because he just feels like he's being salacious or in bad taste.
Skippy Lowe is a beloved Facebook friend. You know, I don't. How could you be nasty?
You are the person that turned me on to Skidoo.
Skidoo.
One thing I remember reading is that during the making of Skidoo, Carol Channing was sitting with Groucho Marx, and she goes, "Yo, somebody should shoot Otto Preminger filming this movie," and he goes. Groucho goes, "Someone should shoot Otto Preminger, period."
Wonderful.
And then I heard during his, when he was having a bad acid trip, he said, "I can see Laurence Olivier fucking Danny Kaye in the ass."
What are the odds of that?
Frank, you mentioned I turned you on to Skidoo.
You did.
I had a cassette tape of it.
I have one.
I think Gilbert and I watched it back at my apartment
in the old 80s.
But I kept sending it to people I was trying to get rid of
you
it.
You sent me a VHS.
And it kept coming back to me.
Right. By the way,
I still have it.
We had Frankie on the show. We had Frankie Avalon on the show, and I got him to sign a DVD for you, which I have at home,
really?
I keep forgetting to give it to you.
A lot of those guys were convinced that was going to be their career comeback, like Groucho, too. He thought he was going to be relevant again by appearing in Skidoo and Frankie Avalon.
Preminger was sort of briefly blacklisted within the industry after that movie. Robert Evans was head of Paramount at the time, and he felt that Preminger was intentionally making a bad movie to sabotage Paramount and make them go broke because he and Evans didn't get along.
It's unlikely because every film Otto Preminger made, aside from Laura, was a bad movie. So for him to direct a comedy, of course it was going to be a disaster.
Well, he didn't direct anything again for another 3 years, I think.
Right. The film with John Lindsay, right? Rosebud?
Oh, Rosebud. Yeah. Well, Bunny Lake is missing is okay.
That has its moments. Interesting cast again.
Yeah.
You know, you got those great British actors.
Right. And that's Where the Sidewalk Ends.
Yeah. He made some interesting films. He did. He was married to Gypsy Rose Lee.
Right. You know? But not a guy to direct a comedy.
He directed Arnold Stang before in The Man with the Golden Arm.
Right, right. Correct. And Frank Sinatra actually like worked well with him. He respected him. You know, for like two times, once with John Frankenheimer in Manchurian Candidate and once with Otto Preminger. Frank actually would do a scene again, you know, those two times.
So, I remember when Gypsy Rose Lee used to come on Merv Griffin all the time. And she was like this disgusting old woman who had that snobbish attitude of, we weren't strippers. Mm. That's what they have nowadays. We were artists.
Performers.
Type, you know.
You still look at her and think she looks nothing like Natalie Wood.
Oh, my God.
No, no, wait a minute. She looked more like Celeste Holm or something like that. Yeah. I mean, like the ugly girl that Frank Sinatra used to get in the old movies. But nothing like young Natalie Wood. Right.
So Harry Nilsson sings the closing credits.
Yes.
Of Skidoo.
And Carol Channing sings the opening.
Yeah. And it's truly wretched.
Skidoo.
It's like, you know, it's yeah. It's like
a post-Betty Davis, post-stroke Betty Davis thing.
How she got in that, because she was a huge Broadway star, and this was possibly like her, you know, she had been in some movies in the 50s.
There are existing rehearsal tapes of Harry Nilsson composing the soundtrack on an acoustic guitar, like trying to go through the melody. And when he's composing the opening song, Nilsson is doing a Carol Channing impression to see how it would sound as with the music. Yeah,
trailer, I don't even think he's in the movie. But in the trailer, Sammy Davis Jr. Pops up. Yeah.
Really?
Well, they got Peter Lawford was in the movie playing a senator, so I guess he just asked his friends to stop by.
And Mickey Rooney's in it. We haven't even mentioned that.
Right. It's an amazing cast.
George Raft, too?
He must pop up.
Yeah, I think he does.
I think so, yeah.
And who's the young girl? Alexandra Ray, I think?
Austin Pendleton.
Yeah, who had long hair.
Right. It's an incredible
he had these long hair types.
And I should add something Cliff pointed out when he came in. Punched up by Rob Reiner.
Rob Reiner, Carl Gottlieb, and other members of sort of counterculture sketch comedy at that time. The committee. Reiner was in a thing with Larry Bishop called...
Joey Bishop's son.
Yeah, I forget what the name of their short-lived sketch troupe was called. But at any rate, Preminger came to see the committee perform at the Tiffany Theater in Los Angeles and hired them because he didn't really know anything about how the counterculture spoke. So Gottlieb and Reiner came down to his office and he said, can you write some dialogue for hippies, and they wrote groovy randomly all throughout the script, and that was great.
Well, Rob Reiner played a hippie a year later on Gomer Pyle, of course.
Yes, you know, and he played a draft dodging hippie in Where's Papa?
That's right.
And he played a hippie in two episodes of The Beverly Hillbillies, color episodes.
Right, and I believe The Partridge Family, did you say that?
He pops up in that. Yeah. Is he in the one possibly with Richard Pryor?
I don't think so. Lou Gossett and Pryor in that one.
There was an actual murder case of this guy who was like a former Marine or something, and he murdered his wife, and he wanted to blame it because the Mansons had already done their stuff. So he wanted to blame it on like a bunch of crazed hippies. So he wrote all over the wall, like, and there's a guy, he's a Marine, he doesn't know hippies. So he wrote all over the wall at the murder scene, LSD is groovy.
That's right.
Skidoo was a genre. There was a genre of those big budget comedies, like relevant hip comedies, which were the opposite.
Yeah.
But the other one was the one with Anthony Newley, and I can't even pronounce the title.
Hieronymus.
Yeah.
Is this?
Yeah. Right. Right.
There was that other one.
Mercy Hump.
Heronius Merkin, that's the one. Yeah. Mercy Hump.
That's the one that has Milton Berle and George
and
Jessel
Find
pop
True
up.
Happiness.
The only,
and it's like, what were they thinking?
The only X-rated film that stars Jessel and Berle.
And there was a spread in Playboy.
That's what you think.
That's how it got its most attention at the time.
There's also another Jackie Gleason comedy that has counterculture elements called How to Commit Marriage, which Professor Irwin Corey is in.
There you go.
And they go to like a psychedelic nightclub, and there's a fake hippie band on stage called The Comfortable Couch. And there are these long hairs. Yeah, and it's pretty dreadful.
Watching him in the late 60s, he just looked so angry.
Gleason,
yeah. Because he wanted to be on the golf course. Right. He just hated, like, seemed to hate the business, especially making movies.
Well, we've talked about it before, and we talked about it on the episode you were on, but it's worth revisiting Skidoo.
Oh, yeah.
If you like bad movies, that's a great one to start with.
Oh, yeah. It's can't get worse.
You can't get worse.
Truly wretched.
You can't go wrong.
Jackie Gleason tripping on LSD has a vision of a disembodied Groucho head on the head of a screw coming towards him.
I mean, and Groucho with the worst toupee he had ever worn.
Oh, yes.
Black.
Yeah.
Toupee.
Yeah.
And he's on the micro. There's a scene of him on the boat where he's repeating the same line over and over. And you just feel sorry for the man. It's just so, like beneath him to be in this piece of shit. But there he is.
Skidoo. Yeah. That's our negative colossal obsession for this week.
Don't miss it.
The show has taken a strange turn, by the way. People are writing us and they're saying, you used to recommend good movies.
Now you talk about pieces of shit every week.
I can't believe it's taken this long before you talked about this.
Yeah, with you we did. But I thought it would be a good something we could all have in common. So, Groucho, you want to take us out?
Well, this has been Gilbert and Frank's amazing, colossal obsession with Gilbert Gottfried and Frank Sancho Padre. And it was at Nutmeg Studios at Nutmeg Post with Frank Vitarosa. We've had Drew Barrymore, who's an artist, and he was an author of a book called The Comedians by the name of
Stephen Feusterman, Nechel Klesterhaus, Clifton Heidelberger, Cliffen Hoffen, Steven Hoff, Hoffen Cliffelman,
Hoffen Cliffelman. That's my favorite. We'll see you next week, guys. Thank you, Drew. Thank you, Cliff.
Very nice.
Thank you, guys.
Fun.